So the topic of my lectures is the following: political connections and corruption. And in the beginning, I was thinking to make the first lecture as a literature review, but then I decided I cannot talk 1 hour about literature review. I just cannot talk about this. And I decided to split it on two parts. And today I will be talking about political connections, and I will be presenting my research, my recent research. But I will put a little bit more emphasis on literature review, which I usually don't do. So you will know the state of the arts in the field, and you will know some results and methodology. I will be focusing on definitions of politically connected companies, on results, and on some methodology which people use. And I will somehow try to answer to the following questions: how politically connected firms are different from non-connected companies, and do politically connected firms shape industry structure? And the second question is particularly related to my work on Indonesia. And on Thursday, I will be talking about another type of corruption, bureaucratic corruption, where firms or bureaucrats, they pay little bribes to each other. And I will discuss whether bureaucratic corruption or petty corruption, how we can call it, help to help businesses to grow or not. And this is also based on two of my papers, and but they're already published, so they're a little bit old. But this one is pretty new, so any comments are welcomed. The title of the paper I'm going to present: Does Cronyism Curtail Competition? Evidence from Indonesia. And this work is together with two co-authors from the World Bank. So the question which we want to answer there is, how do state-business relationships shape industry structure? How they affect competition intensity, and how they can affect dynamic of companies at the industry level? And interestingly, this question was not studied before. In spite of some research on corruption, there is a lot of theoretical analysis on corruption and competition. And there is also some empirical research about politically connected companies and how they are different from non-connected, whether they value more, whether they perform better, and about some anti-competitive practices which politically connected companies face. And I will focus a little bit more on this part of literature later on. So the ultimate goal of our research is to examine whether political connections in Indonesia can affect industry structure and competition. And in order to tackle this research question, we use census data of manufacturing companies. And in this data, we have we have politically connected companies which were identified. In total, we have 269 companies. And we use the fall of Suharto in 1998 as a quasi-natural experiment. So basically, we compare before and after Suharto industries which were more and less politically connected. I know that there are a lot of problems here, and there are a lot of empirical challenges which we should address. I'm not sure that we are addressing them all, but at least we acknowledge them in our paper. And why do we want to focus on industry-level outcomes? Because they matter for allocative efficiency, and they matter for industry growth and general aggregate economic growth. So this is our purpose. And if you are curious about the results, and if you are not very interested in the topic, I can give you results, and then you can relax more. So what do we find in our study? We find that politically connected companies, their market shares decreased significantly after the collapse of Suharto. But this decrease did not translate in a greater dynamism and better competition at the industry level. Okay? So on one hand, we have some effects, but on the other hand, we cannot find any any effects between the Suharto era and after Suharto era. So we conclude that disruptions of political connections had desirable distributional effect, but this impact didn't improve allocative efficiency and didn't improve overall market structure. We do try to explain this in our paper, but we try not to speculate much because there could be various reasons and we obviously cannot explain them all. Okay, now let me go to some literature review. I think the most famous paper on politically connected companies is Fisman 2001. It's one of the earliest work. It's very well known, and this is a seminal paper. In this paper, Fisman defines political connectedness of companies using some index, which was based on opinions of experts. So some experts, they decided which companies are more connected, which companies are less connected. And then using this index and using a market value of companies, he was studying whether politically connected companies overreact on news about Suharto Health. So during some period of time before 1998, there were various news about Suharto Health, and if in the news health was deteriorating, then the value of politically connected companies was dropping. So that was his result. Another very famous and seminal paper is the FISA 2006. In this paper, she uses a different approach. She defines politically connected companies and as companies where shareholders, managers, president of company or vice president of companies or secretary of company are members of parliament, ministers, or closely related to top officials. So this is kind of more formal definition of political connections, which you actually can construct yourself if you have enough of data. And she is conducting analysis using cross section of countries. I think she's using more than 40 countries. She's using companies which are publicly traded, and she finds when all these people affiliated with companies enter politics, then the value of company increases by 2.3%. And she also finds, because she has a country level data, she can also do some comparative analysis, and she finds that higher value following more important connections, for example, it matters whether a manager of company enters a local political party, or he becomes minister, or maybe even becomes closer to president. So all these have a value for companies. And also she finds that higher value is observed, higher value of political connections is observed in more corrupt countries. And the methodology she is using is almost in the same way as Fisman. She is using event study around the events where managers enter politics or when politicians are becoming affiliated with the company. There are another couple of papers which I want to present you about the value of political connections, about market value. The first one is Ferguson and Worth, 2008. So they go into archives and they identify companies which were related to Hitler and to Göring, which was an important minister related to Hitler. So they go to archives, they identify these companies, and as I remember, politically connected companies are those which managers or shareholders were providing some advice to Hitler or were when they providing some financial aid to the party. And they compare performance of companies before January 1933. They compare the performance of companies before 1933 and after 1933 when Hitler came into power. And they found that politically connected firms outperform non-connected by 5-8%. There is also another interesting recent paper, Acemoglu and Company 2018. They use events of from Arab Spring, and they use Egypt. In Egypt, during Arab Spring, the government was changing from initially incumbent government NDP party, then to military-related party, then to Islamic-connected party. And then they were able to identify which companies are connected to which government. And then they observe riots over some period of time. So when there is a riot in Egypt, then this riot is against a particular government. Then sometimes passes by, there is another riot, and they're against a particular government who are in the power at the current moment. Using all this variation, they also find that riots are related to, so the riots reflect how population and companies perceive incumbent government, and they find out that firms connected to incumbent government, they're losing market value when there are riots on the street. So for example, if we will take a paper of Fisman 2001, and if I will take Acemoglu 2018, then already we have some kind of support for our own research that the either bad news of current government or the possibility to remove current government can affect the value of companies and can affect probably through the reduction of privileges which politically connected companies used to get from the government. There is also quite substantial research about political connection, politically connected companies and access to finance. For example, Johnson and Mitten 2003, they do research in on Malaysia, and they find that politically connected companies have higher leverage, and these companies were performing better in spite of having higher leverage when capital controls were imposed in Malaysia. And they use the definition of politically connection. Political connections are almost the same as in FASIO work, so managers or members of board of directors related to politicians or to parties. And in their research, they explore variation in changing of political leaders. So there was a period of time when political leaders were changing in Malaysia, and they are looking at performance of companies which were connected to Anwar or to Mahathir. In another paper of FASIO, 2006, the same year, she finds out that politically connected companies have higher leverage, and the probability of being bailed out during crises is higher for them. In her research, she uses a sample of publicly traded politically connected companies, and she constructs a matched sample of non-connected companies in order to draw her conclusions. And she's doing matching using industry and market capitalization of companies. Another two similar papers, Hivaya and Mian, they conduct research in Pakistan, and they find out that politically connected companies, they borrow 55% more from banks, but they also find that this effect, they also find that this happens because government, state-owned bank are able to provide this additional financial aid to connected companies. And they also, at the same time, they find that connected companies, they have a 50% chance higher to be defaulted. Then similar research on Italy, Infante and Piazza 2014, they use companies which are connected locally to politicians on the municipality level. And they find that connected companies enjoy lower interest rates. And these effects are higher when the bank providing loans is itself politically connected. So probably the CEOs or members of board of directors of banks, they are also related to politicians. They also find that effect is higher if local loan officers have high degree of autonomy or the corruption levels in municipality levels are higher. Then there is a bunch of research from my co-author, Bob Rickers, who spent a lot of time in Tunisia collecting the data and analyzing it. And he produced like three papers on Tunisia. He is using the fact that during Arab Spring, Ben Ali was jailed, and they were able to identify all companies related to Ben Ali. And after he was jailed, all assets of these connected companies, they were like removed. So this is a very nice experiment because we know that Ben Ali was jailed, the company lost all their assets, and the CEOs of these companies were jailed. So this is a very nice experiment where they can really identify companies which are actually were connected. In our case, for Indonesia, as I will be telling later, we do not have this because Suharto was never jailed, and we do not really know exactly what happened to connected companies to Suharto. So Bob finds different practices of anti-competitive practices. For example, he finds that politically connected companies can evade tariffs, they can evade taxes, and they also perform better in more regulated industries, which manifests for state capture by politically connected companies of the industries. then I will, my two papers in this literature review are related to Europe, first France and then Italy. In the paper Bertrand et al. 2018, you can see that the definition of politically connected companies is a little bit widened. So they define companies politically connected if its CEO was previously served as a minister or graduated from these two elite schools in France. So apparently in France, educational system is not very democratic, and there are elite schools where people network, and then they usually go to businesses, and they do work with each other. But in this paper, they actually find that politically connected companies, they help to politicians. They help to kind of to buy votes, they help to improve electorate. What does it mean? It means that once, if we have politically connected company, then this company usually employs a higher amount of workers, and higher amount of workers means more loyal votes for the current government, but also more, but also high amount of employees leads to leads to like more inefficient performance, to less productivity, and so on. They even find that when firm hires a politician, then the productivity and the growth of company goes down. And in this paper, they utilize a lot of different data. They have administrative data, they have municipal election data, and some others. In another paper based on Italy, they also utilize a lot of different data sets. Administrative data on workers, registry of local politicians even, security, social security data, and I don't remember exactly, but I was very impressed how much data they use. And once you have that much data, you can do whatever you want. So they use another definition of politically connected companies. They take explicitly registry of local politicians, and then they match them with employment data from Social Security. What do they find? They find that politically connected companies, they are huge, they have a lot of market share, they are basically leaders in the industry. They are less likely to exit, but at the same time, they are less likely to innovate. They also find that more politically connected industries are less dynamic. And this is basically the only research which was trying to do something at the industry level, which is related to our own research. So methodology is the following. They run just simple OLS regressions, or they try to do regression discontinuity design. So as you can see in this strand of literature, the methodology which people use are pretty standard. These are just OLS regressions, some regressions on the matched sample, in some cases regression discontinuity design, if there is a possibility, like here. And in our paper, we also do not do anything sophisticated. We run straightforward regressions, and we somehow try to account for data limitations. So let me go back to the paper which I want to present you. So the main hypothesis is that once Suharter was removed from the power, then politically connected companies, they lost their privileges. So this is our hypothesis, and we want to test it. Once they lost their privileges, they probably were not able anymore to create barriers to entry for other companies, in a plain English. If they cannot do this, then we expect that after Suharter, the entry and exit rates in industries should be higher, the intensity of competition should be higher, and market concentration lower. And we basically try to test this. Our identification comes from difference in difference methodology when we compare the period before Suharter with period after Suharter. And we also argue that in industries which were more connected to Suharter during Suharter era, the pro-competitive impact should be more pronounced. So you already may imagine what kind of difference in difference strategy we have. We have a period before Suharto, after Suharto, and we have a measure of presence of politically connected companies at the industry level. In a classical situation, we could have a dummy variable for industries which are politically connected. But we wanted to explore, so we wanted to have continuous measures. So some industries are more connected, some industries less connected. But eventually, since we do not have any significant result at the industry level, our measures do not matter much. Before going into details of our empirical strategy and results, I want to give you a brief introduction of Suharto era. So Suharto came in power in 1968, I think, and he created a circle of close confidence. They were his family members, indigenous Chinese businessmen from the past, and also the former military guys. The types of business privileges they were getting are protections from disruptions, cheaper licenses or free licenses, cheaper access to land, to finance, and so on. All standard anti-competitive practices which are related to political connections. But in spite of all this structure, Indonesia was growing pretty well. For example, Indonesia experienced very high growth during 90s and 80s. But suddenly, or maybe not suddenly, in 1997, 1998, Asian crisis happened and Suharto couldn't manage it, and Indonesia was affected the most among southeastern countries. Economy contracted by 13%, there were riots on the streets, and Suharto resigned in May 1998. And after he resigned, I forgot his name. So after he resigned, the next president was actually his protege, and I forgot his name. And that's why we also do not know exactly what happened to politically connected companies, to connected companies to Suharto, because the next president was his protege, and maybe nothing, we cannot observe anything substantial because of this fact, or maybe because of other reasons. So after the crisis, Indonesia undergone a lot of liberalization reforms, democratization, deregulation, and some banking reforms, private sector reforms. For example, some product and trade monopolies were eliminated. There was created a competition commission chasing uncompetitive behavior of companies. And some restrictions were also relaxed. But all these reforms, of course, were very slow, often inefficient, and so we don't really know to which extent they were implemented, because this is Indonesia. Now I will go to the empirical part of the study. I will talk first about data sources. I will give some descriptive analysis, and then I will show some regression analysis, although you already know the results. So the data. Indonesia is a lucky country because after the crisis, international organizations such as World Bank and IMF, they were patronizing the country and they were very eager to collect data. That's why Indonesia has very good data on many aspects, including annual manufacturing census data. This data which we use, it covers virtually all countries with a number of employees higher than 20. And the data is very detailed. It has information on industry, employment, assets, output, value added. In some years, there are some additional variables. Of course, data is a little bit messy, and we had to do a lot of work to clean it. But this is one of the most detailed data set for developing countries, and many papers use this data. Then we take we were lucky, and we were not trying to identify politically connected companies from Indonesia themselves. We took the data from other paper. So we took the data identified politically connected companies from the paper of Mubarak Porbasari 2006, where we can use 269 companies. How these guys identified politically connected companies? So first of all, they took methodology of FISMAN 2001, and they were trying to identify firms, big conglomerates, which were overreacting to Suharto Health. Once they identified these big conglomerates, they figured out the shareholders, members of the board of directors, and they were trying to find what other companies or subsidiaries related to these conglomerates. So by doing this, they expanded the sample of companies from FISMAN 2001 paper. So using the period before 1997, they identified these companies, and then they were tried to match these companies to manufacturing level data using 2007 year. So because they used only this year, we know for sure that in 1997, in the manufacturing census data, we have this and that companies are politically connected. But we do not really know what happened in the data to these companies. So in the data, we can observe them because we have a panel, but we do not really know whether these companies lost their connections or whether not, or whether companies were related to Suharto before 1997, how strongly they were related to Suharto. So basically, we do not know all this information, but we know that in 1997, this and that companies were politically connected. Because of this limitation, we, for our industry level regressions, in order to compute the presence of political connected companies measure, we use 1996 and 1997 years, and we use the market shares of politically connected companies at the five-digit industry code in order to compute market shares of politically connected companies, and we call this measure at the presence of political connections at the industry level. So this is how we measure the degree of connectedness of industries to Suharto, okay? And of course, our data has some other limitations. For example, connected companies identified by methodology of Mubarak and Kubarsari, they can over-identify or under-identify connected companies, and we cannot control for this. Another big limitation for our study is that we have connected companies only at the manufacturing level, while connections more often happen at the other sectors, in telecommunications, in banking, finance, and some other services sectors. So this is also, I think, a big limitation, because for manufacturing sector, we could identify some limited effects. To start with descriptive statistics, I can say that using our data, the number of connected companies are pretty small. It's just 1% of the sample. But these companies, they capture about 15% of total output. They employ about 4% of labor. They are big importers and not so big exporters, as we will see. And if we take 2006, 2003 year, then these companies remain to be pretty big and pretty active at the labor and importing market, although the output dropped. So we may already suspect that the market shares of these connected companies dropped as well. Here we do basic, we compare connected and not connected companies, just without controlling for anything. And we use some measures such as market share, labor, import share, export share, and so on, based on the two subsamples before Suharto era and after Suharto period. And again, we find that connected companies, they have a huge market shares, they employ much more workers, import shares are higher. We do not see anything anything different related to export share. These companies also have a lot of state ownership and foreign ownership. Why is it so? Because during Suharto regime, if some companies were allowed to have foreign ownership, then these companies were, they has to be somehow controlled by the government as well. So if there is a foreign ownership in a company, then there is a high probability that there will be a share of state ownership as well. Or there will be a son of Suharto related to the company. That's why we have a high foreign ownership here. Then if we take a look on the period after Suharto, then the differences remain the same. So almost nothing has changed. And if we took the difference between these two, then we can also notice that market share was dropped, which we will also show in our regression analysis, and the labor dropped a little bit. While firm age increased in post-Suharto era, it means that connected companies, they tend not to exit our sample, and so if they do not exit, then they become older. While other non-connected companies, they're a little bit more dynamic. Then this is an example of industries at the three-digit level, while our work is at the five-digit level, with the highest shares of the presence of politically connected companies. For example, we can notice that almost 50% of manufacture of cement and lime products were produced by connected companies. The same is relevant for iron and steel basic industries. Then 40% of product was produced in manufacture of paper and paper products and so on. So we can see where exactly connected companies were operating. Then this is also descriptive statistics. Previously, on the two slides ago, I was showing statistics at the firm level, and this is a simple statistics at the industry level, where we compute different industry outcomes, such as aggregate output, labor, import, export, foreign presence, state presence, which were defined in the same way as the presence of politically connected companies at the industry. I mean that we take a company, and if the majority of ownership of this company owned by a foreign company, that we define that this company is foreign owned, and we compute market share of sales of this company. So this is how we define the presence of foreign and state ownership at the industry level. So if we take a look at these simple correlations, then we can notice that connected companies, they occupy huge industries, which produce a lot of output, which import a lot, less export, so they produce non-tradable goods. They have a lot of state, they operate in industries which are owned by state mostly. They have also these industries have very small entry and exit rates. Price cost margin is pretty high. Profit elasticity is also pretty high. And very high concentration measures measured by Hirschendahl-Hirschman index and market share of four largest firms. These connected companies also located in industries with high tangibility. These three measures we take from a paper of Rajan and Zingales, 1998, where he was studying how financial development affect growth using a pretty innovative methodology back to those times. Then, if we compute the same correlations for the period after Suharto, then we do not see much differences. So already from these basic tables, from these basic descriptive statistics, we can say that probably we will not find anything. And we indeed do not find anything. But nevertheless, we try to conduct some more rigorous empirical research. So this is our methodology. It's pretty standard. The first regression is at the firm level, and the second regression at the sector level. So what do we do? We measure, we want to see what happened to market shares of companies after collapse of Suharto. We compute market shares of companies at the five-digit level. Then this PC is the dummy variable for company being politically connected. This is interaction of political connectedness with post-Suharto period. We control for some other variables, and we also control for interactions between these variables and post-Suharto period. And then here we control just for industry fixed effects and time fixed effects. Because we need to identify beta coefficient. So the regression for sector level basically repeats the regression for which we used for firm level. We have presence of political connections at the industry level times post-Suharto dummy. We have some controls, and we have interaction of these controls with post-Suharto period. And our outcome variables are related to firm dynamics, industry structure, competition, market concentration, and so on. Okay. So as I was telling in the beginning, we have a big econometric issue which we need to address. Yes.
So one clarification question about the previous slide. Mm-hmm. So in your first equation, why don't you have firm level fixed effects? You could do that, right? Then of course you use the PCI variable, but it would be
yes. I think we do it.
I think we do it, but
I don't have it here.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, okay, but I was just clarification. Okay.
Same mistake as with 1993.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah, I think I will have it in the tables later. Hmm? Okay, the main econometric challenge here for us is to disentangle effects from political crisis from effect of other deregulation reforms. Because everything happened at the same time. There was a crisis, then Suharto was removed, then there was a bunch of deregulation reforms happening. So all this happened at the same time, and if we will not try to control for any of this, which we try but with some limitations, then we will not be able to disentangle effect from disentangle effects of political crisis from other crises. So how we try to deal with this? We try to control for financial crisis by using pre-crisis industry level shares of imports, exports, and external finance dependence. External finance dependence is a constant measure from Rajan and Zingales. Because Industries which were more oriented on export or import, they probably were affected the most by the crisis. For deregulation reforms, we try to control using our measure of entry regulation, which was based on investment regulations in Indonesia. Then what else can we do? We control for state and foreign ownership presence before the crisis, and we try to control for, we try to do some robustness checks using, for example, sector-specific shocks, sector-specific trends, and doing some other robustness checks. So this is all what we were able to do to deal with this quite crucial economic challenge. Well, probably many of you will disagree, and that you can say that we do not solve anything, that we cannot identify anything, but again, what can we do? Okay, yeah, let me show the results. So these are firm level results where we try to see how market shares of politically connected companies changed after removal of Suharto. In the first three columns, we do not control for firm fixed effects, and in the last three columns, we control for firm fixed effects. And then we try to do different specifications, where we control with ownership control, without, with interaction of controls with post-Suharto dummy, and so on, using industry year fixed effects, and so on. But everywhere we can see pretty robust result that politically connected companies, they substantially decreased their market share. As I remember, the economic interpretation is about maybe 10-13%. So by 10-13% out of a sample average, connected companies decreased their market shares.
Sorry, just yes. A clarification question. So what the outcome
variable? The outcome.
The outcome variable
is market share of companies. Market share of companies.
1 to 0. 0 to 1.
Yeah, it's continuous variable from 0 to 1.
So this minus 0.01 means 1%.
Yeah, if you interpret like this, but if you will take sample mean, and you compare this effect to sample mean, then relative to sample mean, the effects are about 10-13%, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, but if it's percentage points, it's 1 percentage point.
Yes.
It used to be 13%, it became 12%, but that's not good, right?
Not exactly the same. Not exactly the same, because this is a statistical significance, and when you try to figure out economical significance, you compare. We usually compare to sample means. Okay, let's discuss it a bit later. Okay. These are firm level results. We see that market shares of connected companies, they decreased. So when we go to industry level results, we do not have any effect. So we observe some little increase in exit rates in industries which were more politically connected to Suharto, but we really do not have anything for the other measures. And in our paper, we also try to plot pre-trends and after-trends to see how everything evolves. There is a little sign that competition improved, but nothing is significant, basically. So this is our wonderful result of no result, like in your paper, Alexei. But your research, I think, is more policy-oriented and more important for kids. Then we do a bunch of robustness checks. For example, we control for 5-digit industry-specific trends. We interact 3-digit industry with years and we include these shocks in our regressions. We try to do alternative proxies for political connectedness. We use a dummy variable instead of our continuous measure. We also try to use some alternative proxies for politically connected companies. For example, we restrict our sample of industries. We also have information on the companies which are family connected, which we call family connected or cultivated connections. What does it mean? In our data, we have companies which we know they're directly related to family of Suharto, so through his kids. And we also know which companies are not directly affected, related to Suharto. For example, these are companies who were controlled by his friends or big businessmen who were somehow closely related to Suharto. So we try to do separately for these two measures, but again, we do not find many differences. Then we try to exclude industries with state ownership. We try to exclude some other industries. And yes, again, we try to play with our sample of industries. And nevertheless, we were not able to identify any significant result at the industry level, which is sad a little bit, but there could be various reasons why this is the case. For example, politically connected companies, they were too big to fail. Government, they wanted to keep them, if they want to keep them, and maybe they even were providing them the same benefits as it was during Suharto era. So it could be that nothing has happened to these companies. Although there is some anecdotal evidence that some connected companies, they went out of market, but some connected companies, they were just restructured. For example, I don't remember for which companies, but it was the case as there was a father, the manager of a company. During Suharto crisis, he has to flee to Hong Kong, but his son stepped in and he restructured company and continued to work. Then we know that after Suharto, the next president was actually his protege. Maybe nothing has happened to politically connected companies. Or maybe some companies gained connections. Some companies in the same industries gained connections while others lost, but in general at the industry level, nothing has happened. So there could be various reasons to explain our insignificant results, but we cannot say much here. And this is a conclusion. So in this paper, we use plant-level census data on Indonesia, where we have identified politically connected companies, and we tried to explore what happened to these politically connected companies after the removal of Suharto, and what happened to industries which were more connected to Suharto during his era. And we find that connected companies, the 12%. So we find that connected companies, they experienced a significant reduction in market shares, but this reduction didn't translate in the improvement of competition at the sector level. So on the more, there was a redistribution of resources in the country, but we cannot observe direct improvement in allocative efficiency, which could have translated in a better performance of at the sector level and at the country level. So this is all, and then I have here some references. If you would like to have this presentation, so then you can check references. Thank you. I will appreciate any comments if you have. Maybe you have some ideas. And some explanations why this happens, why we don't have anything. Maybe we have bad data.
I mean, I very much like the paper. I think the results are pretty much no results, as you said, because some coefficients are significant, but as you said, even if it's 10%, economic significance is not a lot. Yeah, people will, I guess, ask what you could look for with them, yeah. But, I mean, I didn't want to come first, but, you know, I wanted to do this. I have a question. I mean, what I'm missing in this paper is context. Because I like the technical stuff you presented and robustness checks and how you've done this and education strategy and how you do this, how you do things in economics. And I enjoy this because I'm interested in this. I'm interested in methodology. But I think most people are not going to be interested in this at all. And what they want to know is Indonesia, political regime, influence on economic behavior. So what I was missing in this paper is on context, right?
Mm-hmm.
How things are so in Indonesia, you know, a bit of history. So when you write it up, I know that that's not how you do it when I economic journals, but then I think that would be the correct way of doing this. You know, write about the history of Indonesia and about the relationship between politics and firms and business in Indonesia. Give us this content, give us history, then you have your results. And all this technical stuff should go to appendix, really. I know that not how you do this, but I think that idea that's the right, the correct way of doing it. Because when you go to a restaurant, right, you order a dish, high restaurant, high cuisine, then you get it, yeah, they wait to bring this to you, and they may say a few words about how they cooked it, right? But then you eat it. You don't sit there for 20 minutes listening. We did this, you know, that's how we ate this, we did this. It's too technical. I want to know more about Indonesia, and I want them to know more about Indonesia. Although personally, I very much like technical data, and I think of it through, I mean, the way you deal.
I have a suggestion, actually. So now you have an average effect across sectors, but you can ask yourself, for which sectors are political connections important? And there's a lot of literature that says the connections are especially important for sectors that are not competitive,
mm-hmm.
or that are very heavily regulated in some way or other.
So what I would do is I would try to interact your political connected variable with sector characteristics.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have an average effect, which is really small.
Okay.
You say it's 10 to 20% because I suppose the average for your market share is more or less 10% or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
For your sample. So it goes 1% down and you're saying it's 10%. 10%
yeah.
out of... So it's 1% is 10% out of 10, but
yeah.
it's still small.
About
but that. I think for some sectors, the regulated and the uncompetitive is going to be a lot larger because these are the sectors where... political connections matter because they can protect you from too much regulation. They can protect you from regulation in terms of competitiveness. So the intensity of the treatment should be very different. So I would interact with it if I were you.
Okay, you suggest this for our firm level.
No. Actually, both.
Yes, because from our data itself, we can see. Which industries are like less dynamics, which industries have less competition already.
So how many industries do you have?
So we have about 200 something.
So rank them according to competitiveness or rank them according to concentration and take the 25 lowest, 25 highest and
yeah.
look at the difference. And
mm-hmm.
so create this dummy variable for high regulation, high competitiveness, this kind of stuff. These are typically the capture
mm-hmm.
sectors and interact with your variable and then you should see a much larger value. And then,
yeah.
and then you, otherwise, this is going to be the day of insignificant results. But in this
mm-hmm.
case, maybe you have something that works. Huh?
Yeah, we need to get at least little significance.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. That's a good suggestion. And for Alexei, well, we try in the paper to give a little bit of Indonesian context. And I tried to give like on two slides, but unsuccessfully.
No, you did very well, but I just want to know more.
Want to know more? Yes, please, John.
I have a general comment and then some suggestions. General comment is, I'm still not sure what we learn from this. let's say you had perfect identification, and you could say with probability 0.99 that the loss is, or the gain, whatever, is 15%. What do we learn from that? I mean, the point is that except as a policy paper, we know that connected people and connected companies benefit. So what? Why do we care about the specific number? So that's a general issue. And after all, I mean, if you got, say, 15% in Indonesia or even 5%, and you got 20% in Egypt, and you got 90% in another country, what does it tell you except that in different places, the nature of crony capitalism differs? Mm-hmm. That's one. In terms of the specific, there's a couple of things. One is that since I know the Philippine context well, which is quite similar to Indonesia, and the Marcos years especially, there's two questions. One is that even though somebody goes up and down, there's a broad set of interconnected companies which are often have connections to both groups. I mean, to all, right? And so you still need to be connected to a connected company.
Mm-hmm.
And some people will switch sides very easily. So even identifying that these companies are this faction and these companies are that faction, I think you don't understand the extent to which, I think in Southeast Asia, you have competition among the connected families, but not between the connected and the non-connected. So mm-hmm. when one connected family goes down, it's just a relative shift, but it's a small one because you still have to keep that same group. That's one. Then the specific criticism is that the data may be bad in multiple ways, not just in terms of, and so I don't know this part about Indonesia. For example, are there shorting markets? What are the restrictions on the capital market? To what extent are reporting very accurate? There's a lot of problems I see. I'm flying to Manila in a couple of weeks and doing consulting, and there's a lot of problems with bank data. And I know from anecdotal evidence in many of these countries, there are very complicated ways of paying for things to minimize taxes. So this is not how it takes place, but imagine that one of the ways you avoid it is that you're going to trade a building between two really connected families, and you want to avoid taxation, so it'll sell or buy at $10 million, but there's an extra $20 million that's changing hands in Hong Kong, and that's part of the deal, but you never get to see that, and so that's how you get huge amounts hidden in the economy, and it's much harder to monitor that than it is in Western countries.
Yeah, I agree. So the first your comment when you said what we actually learn, what we wanted to see in our research is that, so we know that there are anti-competitive practices, but we wanted to see how these anti-competitive practices affect industry level outcome, and whether the removal of privileges, which we could potentially have, improve industry structure. So we wanted to see this. Because before, there is no research which has been done at the industry level. And basically, of course, we know that this is obvious. Connected companies, they get some privileges. They create barriers to entry. But we wanted somehow to quantify this, and we wanted to see whether the removal of privileges will also improve industry structure, which we didn't find. But your comment is very relevant. Maybe we need to put more emphasis on why we are doing this. Then, what was the second one?
Well, the second is based. Is another way of sort of saying your first answer is naive in the sense that the ways in which companies are connected and the politics are very complicated.
But actually what you are saying that connected companies, they compete with connected, not connected with connected, it's in favor of our results of having no results.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So we should... We should mention this. I don't think we talk about this at all. So if there is, if everything happens in the same industries, then there is nothing after removal of Suharto. So the same, everything remains the same. Yeah. And about data, yes, there are problems with data. But for Indonesia, as I understand, World Bank controls data collection process. Of course, they're not perfect, but who is perfect?
It's more than that. I'm sorry, I work with the World Bank in the Philippines. Yes. It's so bad, I can't, I'm sorry.
But we don't have anything better. Well, in this situation, we shall do case studies.
Yes.
How we can quantify everything. thanks a lot for your comments. Yeah, I will take them into consideration. Anything else? Then thank you for your attention.